Welcome to the WRL Daily Download. I'm Julian Grace. Today's deep dive is part two of a special two-part series about the talk, the conversation Black parents have with their kids about how to navigate encounters with police, and how that talk has played out in my own family over the generations. It's 1980-something, and my dad is a young married father of three. He just wrapped up his day shift, and he's headed home to enjoy the 4th of July with the family. He admits he's a little excited to get home to some barbecue, and that he's probably a couple of miles over the posted speeds. Now, if my dad says he's over the limit, believe me, he is over the limit. He is the godliest man I know. For example, I've once witnessed him offer to pray for a man who called him a racial slur. That's just who he is. I digress. Back to the story. My dad is pulled over by an officer for speeding.
He stopped me and told me to get out of the car. He had a woman police officer with him. She looked like she was in training. And he told me to put my hands on the roof of the car. And I did what he said. I got out and put my hands on the roof of the car.
My father says he followed every command the officer gave him without making any threatening gestures or opposition, but he could tell the one with the badge felt uncomfortable.
He told me to turn around. Well, when he told me to turn around, he put his hand on his pistol. His pistol was in his holster, but I didn't like that, you know, and that was probably the only time I ever known that I said something back to him. I told him, I said, man, you don't have to go through all of that. I said, you don't have to put your hand on your pistol. I said, I'm not going to do nothing. And he told me to be quiet, or shut up, or something like that, he said.
My dad didn't say another word. He obeyed all the commands, and although he never threatened the officer, it was clear the one who had his hand on the revolver felt vulnerable. And my father knew just one more question about that officer's tactics would not go well.
This is the way I feel. If I had been aggressive or mouthy, he might have would have shot me, or he would have got me in handcuffs and he would have taken me to jail.
A New York Times investigation found that Black motorists were overrepresented among those killed during traffic stops. Even though this study was conducted a year ago, my father was well aware of the consequences he could face in the 80s if he were to just question the officer's methods. That is why he showed restraint and suppressed his thoughts on that 4th of July day.
I probably would have been in jail, and I probably wouldn't have been eating no ribs for the 4th. You know, so that's why I was saying, you know, a lot of times you got to be now, the Bible says this. You have to be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove.
What would you tell Azzy and Garrison and Noah and Jacob and Justice?
Don't challenge the police. Whether they're right or whether they're wrong, don't challenge them.
What if an officer does something? What if an officer pulls you over and gets smart to you? Well, what should you tell the kids to do?
If they say something smart, you know, you just got to go with it, you know. Let them talk.
More after the break. It's the 1960s, and my dad is in the back seat of my granddad's sedan. I'm told my granddaddy was headed down the freeway at high speeds and enjoying a summer breeze as the family drove through the land of Lincoln, also known as Illinois. When abruptly, red and blue lights lit up his back seat.
The policeman stopped him for speeding, and my dad kept telling him, yes, sir, no, sir, yes, sir, no, sir, you know. And I couldn't understand why he was addressing him, the policeman, that way, you know, because to me, it was like he was being scared. But later on, I found out.
That traffic stop ended the way it's supposed to. As a traffic stop, the officer issued my grandfather a ticket, and he drove on to his next destination. But for my father, that day shone a long overdue light on the tightrope most Black people feel they walk when addressed by an officer. Some feel compelled, as my grandfather did, to use every pleasantry to illustrate he's not a threat, even if the officer is decades younger. It's no surprise why he would feel that way. A New York Times article attempts to explain why. The report shows that in Minneapolis, Minnesota, police officers' use of force against Black people happens 7 times more often than against white people. There is fear that police departments are encouraging a culture of aggression toward Black people. This summer, the Farmington Hills Police Department in Michigan issued an apology after photos of Black men with guns were used as targets at the department's gun range. No diversity in the lineup, just Black men holding guns. In the 60s and 80s, when my grandfather and father had those experiences, there were no camera phones, nor were officers equipped with body cameras. So on just about every stop, it would be the officer's word against the driver's. Over the course of my life, I've been taught to speak up for myself, to say it loud, to stand up in the face of opposition, no matter the circumstances. Except when dealing with an officer. During these encounters, I'm told to suppress my frustrations and the feelings to be heard, despite possibly being in the right. Taking this passive approach leaves me feeling like a coward, a punk, and ashamed.
What do you guys think about police officers?
Now I'm passing those strategies on to my 4 children who have questions of their own about officers.
So I have a lot of friends that are police officers, but I've also had some bad experiences as well. I've had an experience when I was driving, minding my own business. I wasn't breaking any laws, and a police officer pulled me over, brought in dogs to sniff out my car. They pushed me to the side for a while as they searched my vehicle, and they treated me like a criminal, and I felt bad.
And what'd you say?
Said it again.
What'd you say to them?
I didn't say anything.
What did they say to you?
They can just search your car?
They can just search your car without a warrant.
In that situation, he asked if he could search my car, and I said yes.
Why'd you not say no?
I was scared. I didn't know what to do.
I would say no.
Why would you say no?
Because I'm Black and I'm driving. Like, I would ask, like, what is the reason you need to search my car before
you
I would say yes or no?
You can't talk to a police officer like that.
That's not rude. I would just ask, like, why do you need to search my car right now? There's nothing that you really need to see in here. There's nothing bad in here. Why do you need to see what's in my car?
I think he'll probably arrest you.
What did you say, Jake?
I don't think you can talk to a police officer like that.
Because you can't be,
because he can arrest you for doing that.
Why do you think he can arrest you for doing that?
Because some police officers have short tempers, I think. Like, they're edgy.
Yeah, that's their problem.
So, Christian, you're saying if you were pulled over, that you would say, why are you pulling me over? And that if he asked to search the car, you would say, no, you can't search the car.
I would ask him first, like, if there was a good reason why he needed to search my car. But if he was like, I just need to search your car, then I would say no. I mean, I would ask him. I wouldn't just immediately let him go in my car because I don't know what he's doing. He might be trying to plant something in order to make it look like I did something.
Hmm. How do you feel about that, Jody?
I feel like the color of our skin doesn't matter anymore, but people are just proving me that, like, it does matter and it matters what we treat you with. So I feel like it shouldn't happen, but it does happen, so...
All right, Christian, Jacob, and Jody, you guys all bring up really good points. This is what I want you guys to do, though. If you're ever pulled over by a police officer, I want you to put your hands on top of the steering wheel. I want you to kind of open your hands like this, leave it on the steering wheel so the officer knows that you don't have anything in your hands. And listen to me, Jake, listen, I know you got a question. I want you to hold that question because I want to ask you about it. I don't want you to reach for anything until the officer asks you to get, he might ask you to get your driver's license or registration, and then you ask him, can I get it now? It's very important that you don't make any moves. Now, Christian, I like what you had to say, and I think that's very thought-provoking. But when you're stopped by an officer, your main objective is we need to get you home. So if they want to search the car and you know that you haven't done anything, let them search the car. Your mom and I, we will deal with whatever situation if we felt like you were done unjustly.
Whenever I get a car and I just start driving and a police officer pulls me over, which I bet will happen, before they can search my car, can I call you? Will they let me call you guys?
They probably will not. Not in that moment. Why? So that's what? Because you're old enough to drive. And since you're old enough to drive, that means you're old enough to face the penalties.
If I'm like 16.
Right. Now, if you're arrested, that's a different situation. Now, listen here. I've been pulled over before for speeding, for not wearing my seatbelt, for making a wrong turn, for having an expired tag. I've been pulled over for those reasons, and those reasons are legitimate reasons. Because just because an officer pulls you over doesn't mean he's pulling you over because you're black. You know that, right?
Yeah.
You know that? Do you guys know that or not?
Yes.
But there are some situations where because the way that you look, some people are going to think that you're up to no good. How does that make you feel when you think that?
Honestly, that's frustrating.
It's frustrating, it's hurtful, and it's a pretty heavy weight to carry. Yet I can't leave them in this moment of frustration without concrete tools to carry with them.
Let me ask you this, walk me through. If you're pulled over or stopped by an officer, what are you gonna do?
Put my hands on the wheel. When they ask me to get our stuff out, I'll say, may I, or something. And if they don't, then I'll just still put my hands on the wheel and wait for them to give me orders.
I think that if a police officer pulled me over, was that the question you asked, right? And when I'm driving, I would like do with justice at the beginning, but then when the police officer comes to my car, I would ask him, what did I do? Is there anything wrong? Is my license plate expired? Is there something I need to know of? Was I speeding or something? Because I would want to know what I did to get pulled over. So let me do it again.
Let me ask you this. When an officer pulls you over, is that a time to argue with an officer? Should you be arguing with an officer?
No, I would say it politely. And if he doesn't want to tell me what happened, I would just let him see what's in my car. And then I would have to tell you and mom what happened later.
That's just what Eddie Winslow did in the Family Matters episode I shared in the first podcast. He realized he was stopped unjustly and profiled. He followed the orders and informed his dad. Okay, so I figured it was time to show my crew the 8-minute clip of the Family Matters episode that caught my attention. Remember, Eddie's father, Carl, is a little skeptical of his son at first, thinking Eddie may have been driving recklessly.
What did you think when you saw that clip?
That his father should always trust his son. Would you trust me if I said that?
Jacob, would I trust you? I would want to trust you. What I will say is I want to know all the facts. I want you to tell me everything that you said happened, and then I want to see what the police report says happened.
I think it would really hurt if I was telling the truth to my parents that I went through a really hard time and you guys didn't believe me. I think that would really hurt.
Then my tribe comes up with a practical solution, one I wish I had the foresight to do when I was 16.
I'll go straight to the chief's room and complain about what his policemen did. Yes, at that time I would definitely file a complaint because of what my son is telling me. I would definitely go up and then file a complaint about that officer.
I would file a complaint because that's not right and that should be taken care of.
Over the years, I wondered if that officer who profiled me did it again to other people of color. I wish I would have filed a complaint. Maybe, just maybe, that level of documentation on the officer's record would showcase there is a problem. So I found it suitable to speak to my children and the next generation of those racially profiled so they will know they are not alone. And judging from these conversations, this next generation is willing to hold people accountable for unacceptable behavior. Sharing this journey has been exhausting yet vitally important. There were moments when I wanted to stay quiet and not utter a single word of what I experienced. Yet that would not be fair to me as a 16-year-old boy who needed an advocate, nor would it be appropriate to just forget the stories of my father or my granddaddy. This This series was written and produced by me, Julian Grace. Rachel McCarthy helped with editing. Ashley Talley is our executive producer. Thanks so much for listening to this special episode of the WRL Daily Download, and thanks for making us a part of your morning routine. Another great way to get WRL news is the Morning Briefing Newsletter. It's a daily email that's waiting in your inbox every morning with Triangle news, events, and headlines to get you ready for the day. Sign up at WRL.com/newsletter.